Well, that's my normal trick. I forget what I'm doing and then let it go everywhere.
F***ing booming, that is. F***ing look at that puppy.
Listen to it roar.
Put an LS3 in it. Hi, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Mahker. Today, I'm with my new addition. This is Brutus, everybody. Say hello, Brutus. Come here. Who's this? So he's a baby Doberman, for those of you that don't know him. And he's full of character, and he's learning the workshop slowly, should we say. But anyway, today I'm going to give you an insight on what's going on in the workshop and what the lads are up to. And actually, what I've been busy with is getting stuck into wiring a winch up on the back of a vehicle today and chasing parts. And also, fantastic news, we've got Tom's 90 singing. So on Thursday, we're going to do some tuning and hopefully get it up the road and give it back to Tom, all being well. So tune in, guys, and stay fixed. Come, Bridget.
Okay, Dave, Project Christine, where are we at?
Right, so we've nailed the gremlins, and what we found out what it was, you see here, it was a wrong calibration. Right, so I had a chat with Jim from Zero Gravity, and I was like, Jim, what's going on here? And he had a look inside and realised that the company Mast Motorsport that sent me the 2600, basically the controller, had loaded the wrong calibration to the file for what we need for the gearbox. So if you look now, Ed, come on.
Ready?
So if you look now, go on.
Start it.
No. Push it, slow it down for me. So slowly, Edward. You've got a touch of
yeah.
So you see that? Come back off. Right, start it up. So from Friday, when you saw the last video, you'll notice that this was very sporadic. Give it a blip. Now we've got it responding exactly how it needs to respond. So problem solved, and we're doing some rolling road tuning on Thursday.
What's this, Nicky?
I'm making another catch can. I've made one previously. So we've got engine coolant in one side and charge cooler coolant in one on the other side. So just fabricating it up. This is going to be the shell. It'll have a diverter on the inside. So we obviously have two compartments then. Obviously have drains and outlets and a cap on the top, just like this one I made previously for Gary's car. Just one of them, making another one of them for another customer.
So this one was made for, it's an LT4, isn't it?
LT4, yeah.
What's this new one going with?
You'd have to ask Dave, I don't know. I'd imagine same engine. because it's having the same tank. But this is the first one we've done, well, in this workshop anyway. So it'll work well, and I think it'll be quite popular.
So we saw Nick making another of his dual reservoirs earlier. The original, this is Gary's LT4, isn't it?
Yeah, so this is Gary's supercharged monster. So this week, Nick's been fitting, you see down there, that gigantic P38 steering box. So our friends at Blackbird Industries supplied us that kit, cracking bit of kit and very well engineered. So hats off to James for coming up with that cracking idea.
So what is the new reservoir that Nick's made?
So the new reservoir is for another customer, Rich, who's bringing his 90 into us. And that is also going to be having a crazy supercharged LS3. So Rich is of the crazy variety, like myself, and that's coming soon. So that car will be in, I want to say, give him a couple of weeks and it'll be in here. So we're going to go for supercharger. Blackbird have made the charge cooler for that one. So we're just basically doing the bit in between. It's quite nice, really, because Ian at IRB has done a fair bit of work on it. The guys at Blackbird have done a fair bit of work on it. And I want to say we're all within like a good hour and a half. And it's nice that a few companies can all put their bit on the table, which is, it's going to create one hell of a car, if anything.
This looks like a pretty much complete job now, is it?
That is because it is. We're just taking off all the bits of tape in now. But yeah, all the tough coating's all done. And yeah, I think it looks loads better. Both axles have been done, but they're heavy duty. They're the really heavy duty axles. So you'll notice the front one's just down there. You'll notice that the swivels are, they're welded on to the end of the axle. So yeah, just got to put loads of tape on around the swivels, wrap them up nicely, make sure it doesn't get any tough coat on the swivels. Then obviously they're not really gonna work as they should. So, but yeah, it's all done. We'll just be starting to build it back up again now. I believe he's having a few parts powder coated. But yeah, it's just having a nice freshen up, really. It's really nice truck, so it's good to keep on top of it. This rear cross member has gone in a nice satin black. It's a bit, I've just taken the wrapping off, as you might have seen, so it's a bit dusty now. It was nice and shiny before. But yeah, start building it up and job will be a good one.
If you like it, please subscribe. So many of you have been interested in this coating. So this is my three-stage coating. So underneath this, so introduce this project. This is Project Cerberus. This car was built some years ago. It's a supercharged engine with a big blower on an LS3 setup. So it's not a car to be frowned at, if you like. So this coating is tough coat. This coating goes on top of, we use a thing under here called graphene primer. So what we do, we T-wash the chassis to start off with. We give it a really good etch, and then what we do, we sand off things like impurities, things where galvanizer's gone fluffy, and bits where zinc fluffs up on welds. I'm sure some of you have seen it. And then what we do is we fully wipe down the chassis with T-cloths and thinners to basically get anything off the chassis, you know, grease, silicons, anything like that that contaminate it. We hit it with the graphene primer. The graphene primer literally pulls itself into the materials, and then we hit it with tough coat. And as you can see here, you can probably hear that. So it's quite a rough finish. This finish is arduous to things like stones, pressure washing and things like that. We've got this finish on cars that we've seen now, it's 10 years old, and the Kent that make this product for us, and we will be selling it, guys. If you want to buy a DIY kit, we can sell you a few bottles, we can sell you the applicator gun, if I can find one to show you. I think Bruno's done a very good job at hiding them this week, but I can sell you a kit, and I will be doing a kit soon, so keep an eye on the website, guys, and we will be selling a kit. So if you want to come around here, here's actually one here. So you can see the graphene primer, premium anti-corrosion primer for heavy duty use, remarkable corrosion protection, exceedingly strong adhesion. So that is what's important to us, guys, because what I hate is when I see cars years down the line come back into us and I see the paint come off. And it's I don't know, just take a look at some of the underbody companies that are competing with ourselves. And do you know what I hate, guys, is when you see them spraying stuff in and they're spraying it over rust. I'm like, what are you doing? I almost scream at an advert, and it's, you see it inside here. They're literally spraying over rust and they're like, oh, this protects it against further rust. But I'm not, because you are trapping the rust in there and basically covering it with a film of oil. That is not, it's not right in my book. So what we did, we blast it all off. You can see all the equipment, guys. There's the proof in the pudding. There's probably three cars worth of blast on the floor over there. And we do actually recycle, guys. We love recycling products. So you'll see in that corner, we use a very fine sieve and we keep recycling, recycling, recycling. So trying to look after the planet. So this has been hit with T-coat. It's been tough coated everywhere and it's gonna last. And on the back here, we've actually given the car a nice satin finish, because tough coat is a lovely product, but it's not a pretty product. And as you can see here, Bruno's made a beautiful job of painting this crossmember. I can almost eat my dinner off that, I'd like to think. And obviously stainless steel fixings as and where we can possible. We're gonna get this car looking as good as it did, if not better, the day it left us. So this car is gonna be collected tomorrow. And this car came in to us a couple of weeks ago and for the full underbody treatment. So satin black rear crossmember and tough coat, let's say 95% the rest of the chassis. So it had the full blast treatment. And what we do, guys, we don't just do the bare minimum here. So we've taken things like everything off, we've powder coated it, stripped it all back, stainless steel fixings as and where possible. And we go the extra mile, guys. I always touch base with my clients and say, would you like me to do this? Would you like me to do that? And with every blast off, you get a nice wheel carrier, free of charge. How about that? Sorry, wheel cover, not wheel carrier. Take the words back out of my mouth. Wheel cover, before anyone asks for a £900 wheel carrier. Built for 6'4" people, that's for sure. Look at this. Snug, Ben, is the word.
Oof, listen to it roar.
Should you put an LS3 in it?
It'll fit, I reckon. Rear mounted, maybe.
Do you know what I do like about what Suzuki's do, though, is they give you a little telltale down here. Look at this, it says, it's like a do not thrash me sign. I think I should add those into my builds. It says I'm cold.
Oh yeah, I've got that in Subaru as well.
It's a Japanese thing.
Yeah, I think it's just a Japanese thing.
I wonder if an LS3 would fit in there. But anyway, this Suzuki is for sale. My partner Gemma has, I wouldn't say fallen out of love with it, she just wishes it'd be a little bit faster. We thought about doing a turbo conversion, but I don't want to mess with it. It's It's original as far as the wheels and the roof rack. So this is an adventure spec, we're going to call this one. So adventure spec, 1.5 litre, 101 horsepower. It's quite a nippy little thing, really. So for what it is, and it will go absolutely everywhere. We've had it in the field, we've had it on some tracks and some trails, and it's a great little thing. So this is for sale, guys. I'm asking for £28,000. It is VAT applicable. It is a commercial. There's a cage in the back here that I'll show you. Come and have a look at this. So ideal for the dogs. You could put a roof tent on there, go for some little adventures. It's a great little car, really. So if you'd like to take it as it is, with the BF Goodrich KO2s on, Evo Corsa wheels, the front runner roof rack, it can be yours for £28,000. So please get in touch.
Okay, Mike, why are we swapping these winches out?
Well, as that one you can see just there, it's a bit old and tatty now with the wire rope still on. We've got this one, the Rhino winch here with the kinetic rope. Bit easier, bit subtle, bit lighter, bit easier to use. It's got the wireless control with it as well. That's better. Out with the old.
Have you had to make any modifications to get this one to?
No, just drill some new holes to bolt the bracket down to it. It's got 8 holes instead of just the 4, because that one's bolted to the bracket, then the bracket's bolted to the frame, where this one, it's all of it's bolted all the way through, secured a little bit better.
Ace, and is there any difference power wise that you've had to?
No, it's the live and the negative the same. It comes through from the earth spot and the battery, and it's exactly the same. It's just a case of swapping it in and out, rewiring it back into the new one, which I've just disconnected it all now.
If you like it, please subscribe.
Okay, what's happened with Churchill this week, Dave?
So this week we've been, God, what have we been doing on this one? So this has had, Darren's been calibrating the new Dakota gauges. I'm sure you saw those. One's really pimp, something we've never done before. Nikki made me a really nice aluminium bezel that's spot on, so Nick, well done on that. And if you want to come and look under here, you can just see the quality and the standard of workmanship you see under the cars, guys. So you can see here how we dress up the cross members, and the beautiful job of Nick's made of that exhaust system, which I must say is just immaculate. And of course, Tom from Winchester did another fantastic job on his stage 2 transfer cases. We can't fault him on those. We've literally probably put 550, nearly 600 horsepower through those transfer cases, and they just keep on giving. So well done on that, Tom. And the rest of it, so these are, so Mayer. These are Mayer's axles. So the guys from Poland, fantastic company and very good engineers, may I add. And if you look at these cases, so these axle cases, I haven't seen anyone else using these yet. So correct me if I'm wrong, guys, if anyone else has got a set out there. And of course, Joe from Pioneer, we love your brake products, mate. It's got brake lines going on it this week. Of course, this has got our monstrous brake kits on the back here, guys. These are 365 millimeter rears, so not to be frowned at. And you can see these cases, these actually, they take a normal Defender diff. So you, but these are obviously the pegged, upgraded options. And of course, from my friends at Winchester, this is running a pegged ATB. Of course, maximum traction and all that lot. Fox remote reservoirs, they've been fitted. This car is literally, guys, this is what I class as a blank check build. So it's had everything, absolutely everything. And I think it just needs prop shafts. It's all there, as in on the key right now. So prop shafts, and I want to say we're there. So there you have it.
What have you been up to today here?
Basically, I've been modifying this tank for to have some tow bar hitches connected to the chassis, into the back of the tow bar, because they're heavy duty, they're like 12 mil thick. So it just basically fits like that, to be fair.
Ace, so yeah, we've got them on each side then, haven't we?
Yeah. So they'll look like that once they're finished. Let's see if I've got the right side. Like that.
Cool. And what's this sort of gully along the top there for?
Yeah, so basically that hole and that tunnel's for a fuel sender. A fuel pump and sender, yeah. So it's all hidden and out of the road, sort of thing. And this is what it looks like from the top. Basically, it's not going to snag on anything of the chassis.
So yeah. What's the next job once we've done that?
I'm going to put it back up on the chassis, make sure everything fits, make sure the brackets are not knocking or catching any of the fuel tank, and then start modifying the rest and building up the rest then.
Who in their right mind adds this to a chassis? Look at it, it's just, and to top it all off, look at my nice pretty fuel tank splattered in the stuff. If you like it, please subscribe.
What's happened with the Cummins here?
So today we've brought the Cummins 130 into the maker shed, and what we're doing today is Darren and Ed have been busy timing up. This is the VE fuel pump. So the original Bosch VE pump was a little tired, a little lazy, so we sent this off to our local Bosch pump shop and got them to liven it up a little bit. So basically bring the fuel in earlier, which gives us better combustion, etc. So that's exactly what we've done. I'm not going to tell you what I've had done inside that pump, because that is a little secret of ours, because if we told everyone what we did, everyone would be copying it. So anyway, this is a 6BT 12 valve. This is probably the most old school and most robust Cummins there probably is out there. As you can see here, they're gear driven, so you've got no cam chains to go wrong, you've got no belts to snap and things like that. So you've got an oil pump down here. You'll notice things like this in things that are very like commercial, industrial diesel engines, things like that. They're literally bulletproof. This engine is known as the million mile engine, as I've previously mentioned. Things like this, you've got a gear driven vacuum pump and steering pump. You know, there's no belt to go wrong. This literally runs a water pump and an alternator. Simple as anything. So this is going to be one hell of a reliable truck for Adam when he gets it back earning a living. And what we've been doing last week, so the shocks and springs went on the front. We're going to go with the remote reservoirs, the Foxes. As we know, this is renowned for being a fantastic setup. And on the back, I spoke to Dan at On Air, and he's given us some rear airbags. So this is going to allow us to as and when Adam loads this vehicle up, being a 130, he's got a big like welfare box that goes on the back, and he's also got a unit that goes on the back towing heavy trailers with steelwork, etc., and concrete slabs. So he can actually tweak the back to suit his desired height, depending on PSI. And I want to say the bags are good for, I think it's just shy of 100 PSI, so he can jack them up a fair bit. And what we're going to do is give him Schrader valves so he can pump them up using his own compressor that's going to be built into the vehicle. So it's going to be a standalone vehicle, if you like. Right, so this 90 came into us, it was about a month ago, maybe 2 months ago, with some very bad tub corrosion. This car originally was put together by our friends in Scotland, Mr. Outlander, and there's certain areas that he's done a fantastic job on, but we just wanted to do the extra mile for the client of ours that we originally did the engine conversion for. He asked us to do the repairs to the tub, so there was some like filler work on the back and some corrosion on the back, so we've tidied those bits up, and what we decided to do in the end was to give the car a brand new tub. So we went all out, we gave the car a tub, and we gave it things like new cappings, because the cappings were like heavily corroded on the edges where the paint had come off. And while we were at it, I asked Nicholas, would you like me to add a wheel carrier? Because we noticed this car is running KO2 tyres. These tyres are far from the original weight, and what they do, they cause a lot of stress on things like the hinges, and you can't get a better job than when you pop it. Look at that, there's no resistance. I can shut this car with one finger. So there's some minor tweaks still left there. I believe Louis was just finishing it off earlier on. But there you have it. So what we do like doing here, guys, is making these cars last another 20 years. We don't just tart them up, add a few brackets to them and send them out the door. We're all about tidying up under there, guys. So renovating the chassis, getting rid of all the rust and corrosion so it just can't spread. Stop it multiplying, and if you look under there, it's immaculate as the outside now looks. So guys, that's it from another busy day in the Mahker workshop. Thanks for tuning in, guys, and thanks for the people that have been subscribing and sharing the love about this workshop. I want to say thanks again to my awesome team, guys, for making my dream possible and basically just making it happen. So thanks again for watching. Please like and subscribe if you haven't already, and bring your cars to me, guys, and let me make them beautiful. Thank you. Bye-bye.